Wow, you found us again. You're here in the Sunlight Studio for the next installment of What's Love Got to Do With It? This is part 5, and I'm so glad you've tuned in. This is not the action adventure, the romantic comedy that you're used to watching on video, but it is going to be every bit as valuable. In fact, it's going to be so much more valuable. And finding God's truth takes some extra work. I know I try really hard to get these to 20 minutes and I'm always pushing it over, but I promise you, if you hang in there for the next 20 minutes or so, you're going to find some real treasure here. And I'm so glad that you joined us. And if you'll stay tuned to the very end, after the song, I got a couple of important announcements that I know you're going to want to hear about as well. So hang in there till the end. As always, like, share, comment where you can. Let us know what you think about what you hear today. And just a real quick shout out to Jake, Saran, and Adam, our Port St. Lucie guys. They're part of our Port St. Lucie campus, our central campus. They painstakingly edit all of these videos, and they bring it together in a beautiful way. They insert the slides and the videos that come along with the message, and they just make it so smooth and watchable. So I am so grateful to those guys. We're going to be looking, as I said, at part 5, Can I Get a Witness, is the title for today. It comes from 1 John 5, verses 1 through 12. Now, before you get there, this is an antique. This couple in Britain bought this chair for £5. You know, around $5. I don't know what the exchange rate is from pounds in Britain, but it's around $5. It wasn't much they paid for this chair, and they put it in the attic. And then after a while, the guy said, I'm going to reupholster this chair. That was the goal. They were going to reupholster and paint the chair. And so he starts to take this chair apart, and he starts to find 3 rings. One of them was a diamond ring. And he's just like, oh my goodness. They come to find out between the age of the chair and these rings that were in there, it was worth £5,000. Just sitting in their attic for years that they bought at some antique sale. I think we have treasure in our attics. And as we look at 1 John 5, we're going to uncover that treasure again. And the first few verses, the first 5 verses of what John says here in chapter 5 is, this is the treasure. Don't miss this treasure. You got to get up early on a Sunday morning. You got to find the YouTube or the Facebook or the website of Sunlight and other places like it and hear messages like this to uncover that treasure. And here's what it says. In 1 John chapter 5, I'm just going to read the first 5 verses and then we're going to come around and we're going to read the next few verses. It says, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. And his commands are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes this world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. And you can see I highlighted in this text 3 times John said, overcomes, overcomes, overcomes. What is it that we overcome in the world? John always refers to the world as this, the cosmos that's in chaos and all the challenges. In a world of disease, we bring healing. In a world of prejudice, we serve those who are different from us. In a world of anger and disagreement, we make peace. In a world of chaos and uncertainty, we bring confidence and rest. There are truths contained here that transform the world. And John says at the core of it is this belief in Jesus Christ. That's at the heart of it. And when you hold on to that core belief, you overcome the world. In other parts of Scripture, it calls us more than conquerors. We overcome, we conquer the challenges that this world has to offer. Do you have things you'd like to overcome? Do Do you have challenges in the midst of all that's going on in our world that you need to overcome? You are destined for this. In the power of Jesus Christ, your destiny is to overcome the world. You were born for it. No, you were reborn in the person of Jesus Christ. You were reborn for exactly that, to overcome the chaos and the challenges of this world. I just want to give you a picture of what that overcoming looks like. It's not a superhero movie. This is Forrest Gump. So let's watch this.
Now, my mom always told me that miracles happen every day. Some people don't think so, but they do.
Hey, dummy! Are you retarded or just plain stupid?
No, I'm Forrest Gump.
Just run away, Forrest.
Run, Forrest! Run away! Hurry!
Get the bikes! Hurry up! Let's get it! Whoa! Look out, dummy! Here we come! Get you!
Run, Forrest! Run! Run, Forrest!
We're back here, you!
You wouldn't believe it if I told you.
But I could run like the wind blows. From that day on, if I was going somewhere, I was running.
If I was going somewhere, I was running. Isn't that a great clip? I love that clip. And I love that scene of Forrest running and the braces falling off of his legs. And he just begins to fly as he runs. It's so fast. The power that John talks about in the person of Jesus Christ, the power to overcome is treasured in this book. Maybe it's buried in your attic. Maybe it's getting dusty. But it's there. And it gives us the power to overcome the challenges of this world and the chaos of this world. Now, what are some of those challenges at the heart of the world that we faced? Well, ultimately, it's the big questions of life. Is there a God? Is there a beginning and an end? Why do I exist? How does God relate to us? Where do we fit in the story? What is my purpose? These are the big questions of life. Sometimes the questions we don't dare to ask because we're afraid of what answers we might find. But these are the big questions of life. And now John turns in the next few verses and he says, there's truth. There's answers to these questions because there's testimony. There are witnesses to this truth. And this is what he says in the next few verses of 1 John. This is the one who came by water and by blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three witnesses that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And the three are in agreement. We accept human testimony, but God's testimony is even greater because it is the testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe in God, who does not believe God, has made him out to be a liar, because they have not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life, And whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Now, this is a powerful section of Scripture. And John says we have reason to believe that Jesus Christ is the center and the answer to our questions because of the testimony. Now, do we need that testimony? Isn't it obvious? We're going to talk about the testimonies first and the witnesses that John talks about in just a moment. But the first question I want to ask is, do we need witnesses? Isn't it obvious that this is true? Isn't it obvious that Jesus Christ is the answer to the challenges that we faced, and following him is the journey that we're on? Well, no, it's not so obvious. Let me just give you a few statistics, and I know statistics can always be, we're seeing so many these days in the news, but 68% of people who identified as Christian said it is more important to identify with some faith than it is to identify with a particular faith. That's two-thirds of people who say that they are followers of Christ say, you know, following Jesus isn't that important. Just find something to follow. Just have a faith. That goes against everything that John just talked about in 1 John 5. He says, if you want to find truth, it is in the person of Jesus Christ. And yet two-thirds of the followers of Jesus Christ say, you know what, it really doesn't matter. Just have some faith. And let's break it down a little bit, because the first group here, evangelicals, which some of us would identify in that category, 56% of us said, you know, it doesn't matter. 56% of evangelicals surveyed said, you know, just have a faith. Pentecostals, it was 62%. Mainline Protestants, 67%. 77% of Catholics said, you know, just have a faith. Doesn't really matter which one. Slightly over half of Christian respondents said they believe that someone can attain salvation by being or doing good. It's basically denying what John's talking about, clinging to Jesus Christ, and saying, you know what, we can just be good people and everything will be okay. That goes against the teachings of John and what Scripture teaches us throughout. And yet so many people say, you know, just have a faith. Just be a good person. And that's all you need. So the treasure that's buried in your attic, we desperately need it. Let me give you one more example. The World Council of Churches in 1994 held a meeting in Minnesota. And it was sponsored by some of the mainline Protestant denominations that you probably recognize because you've seen it on signs driving through the community. And there was a group of them, 2,000, that gathered together. And they said, you know what, we're just going to do something different. In fact, one of the main speakers said, I don't think we need crosses and blood dripping and weird stuff. We just need to listen to the God within. And this is one of the liturgies that they had. Let's give you an example from the World Council of, this is churches. People who confess Jesus Christ got together, and this was one of their confessions. Their creativity produced this. Our Maker Sophia. They're drawing from Proverbs and this idea of wisdom. That's what Sophia means. We are women in your image. With the hot blood of our wombs, we give form to new life. Sophia, our Creator God, let your milk and honey flow. With nectar between our thighs, we invite a lover. I should have told you this was PG-13 today. We birth a child with our warm body fluids. We remind the world of its pleasures and sensations. We celebrate the sweat that pours from us during our labors. We celebrate our bodiliness, our physicality, the sensations of our pleasure, our oneness with the earth and water. Wow. This is like a fertility cult from ages ago. That's what this sounds like. And this is what happens when we just, you know, we take the treasure that is this book and we say, you know what? Let's just listen to God within. Let's not listen so much to this. Let's listen to the God within. Because ultimately, it's anybody's guess, right? I mean, we can just come up with whatever crazy ideas we want to if we don't acknowledge that this book is God's word to us. John says, there's testimony. That verse we had up, at, you know, eight different times John uses the word testimony and testify. And he identifies these witnesses, the water, the blood, the Spirit, the Father. But before this, if you remember earlier in 1 John, the letter, we talked about how John said, I'm a witness. I testify. I saw him. I touched him. I listened to his teachings. Jesus Christ is a historical figure. So he's building on that. And now he's saying there's more witnesses. The water and the blood. What does he mean by that? Seems kind of mysterious. But the water and the blood. And here's what scholars, as they understand John and what he teaches, believe. It goes back to what Jesus says. I am the way, the truth, and the life. This is from John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Here's what John's talking about. The water and the blood. Because some of the people in the church that he's writing to were saying, well, Jesus wasn't fully God. At his baptism, he became, you know, God's Spirit kind of indwelled him. But before he died, God's Spirit left him. That's not what John experienced. That's not what Jesus taught. That's not what Scripture teaches. But this is what those folks were saying. They were trying to diminish the role of Jesus Christ in history and in our salvation. And John's saying the opposite. He's saying, from the moment Jesus began his ministry until the day he died and sacrificed himself for us on the cross, Jesus Christ, his life was the testimony. His death and resurrection, from the moment he was born until the day he resurrected, till his living still in heaven, he is witness to the truth. And at the time of John's writing, there were people who were alive who knew Jesus, who could have testified to these things as well. John's saying it's the life and the person of Jesus Christ. It's his teachings. It's everything contained in the person of Jesus Christ, from water to blood, that give testimony to the truth of Jesus Christ. That truth is ultimately not some doctrines and some ideas and philosophies that we attach ourselves to, but truth, capital T, is a person, is the person of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on. But first, before we go on, let's talk about the nature of revelation for a moment. How do we know that God reveals himself in this way? And part of the nature of the world's view of this is that we live in a closed system. That we are, you know, the earth is contained. And if we're going to find God, the only way we're going to find God is within ourselves, because we live in a closed system. Now, the biblical worldview, what the Bible teaches us, is that God has revealed himself to us. That God has broken into the earth and he reveals himself to us. And this is a picture of Michelangelo's famous painting on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, where God is touching and giving life to Adam. And it's a great picture of how God is intimately involved with his creation. He is intimately involved with us, that God breaks through. And that's part of what we believe about the Bible. It's part of what we believe about who Jesus Christ is, that God has broken into history, has broken into our world, and he has revealed himself to us. And we do not live in a closed system. And if we seek truth, if we truly intend and pursue truth, we will find the person of Jesus Christ. And that's some of the assumption that John is working with and writing about here. The witness of the Spirit, that's one of the other testimonies that John talks about. Now, the witness of the Spirit is in some ways mysterious and mystical. We can't fully understand it. There aren't five steps for you to get filled with the Holy Spirit. It begins by believing in Jesus Christ and intending for the rest of our lives to follow him. And then as we follow Jesus Christ, he begins to break into our lives through his Holy Spirit. And the Spirit in us gives testimony to God's presence in our lives. Sometimes we experience that when I sing with Eli and the team as they lead us on the weekend. I feel and I sense the power of the Holy Spirit as I worship God in song. Sometimes it's when we serve other people. When we find those places and those people where God wants us to serve, that suddenly we begin to feel and experience God's presence in us. One of the most powerful ways over the years in my life when I have felt God's presence and the presence of His Holy Spirit is when I give testimony to the person of Jesus Christ to somebody who doesn't know Him. When I talk to people who don't know Jesus Christ and tell them about Jesus Christ, I'll never forget the first time I did with my friend John, and it was just an incredible experience, and I felt the power of His Spirit. So there are so many different ways that the Holy Spirit gives testimony to who Jesus Christ is as we follow Him in our lives. Now I want to finish with this, the witness of the Father. God says so. Now, we've probably heard sometimes some crazy people over the years who've said exactly that. God says so. Well, is that what John's doing here? Is that what John is finishing with? Is he ultimately just saying, well, God says so, so it has to be true? I don't think that's what John is doing. I think what John wants us to understand is that human prophets use that idea of God says so. It's just what God says. But Jesus said, I am God. He did not say, I speak for God only. He says, I am God. So what I say, God says. And at one point he said, I only speak what the Father says that I should speak. And in the person of Jesus Christ, God is incarnate. He has taken on flesh. He has become one of us as a human being and walked this earth. And you know, there have been other people throughout history who said that they were God, but they don't change the world the way Jesus did. People don't follow them for long when they start claiming to be God, at least not sane people, right? Because they know if somebody starts claiming to be God, they're insane. That did not happen with Jesus Christ. He said He was God, and people still followed Him. In fact, throughout history, millions and millions of people have found truth in Jesus Christ. What Jesus taught us, what Jesus did in our world, it rings true. And that's, if you're uncertain about who Jesus is, I just want you to ask that question as you begin to investigate. Obviously, you're investigating or you wouldn't be this far into this message. And I want you to ask, what you know about Jesus Christ, what you're learning about Jesus Christ, does it ring true? And here are just a few things for you to consider. I believe that's why Christian faith is not bound by ethnicity. It's the only religion in the world that crosses all boundaries. There is not one country or one ethnicity that can say, well, we are the Christian people. Because it is spread throughout the world. And that's amazing. No other religion in the world like it. I believe that's why Christian faith is revealed through a book written over hundreds of years, 40 different authors, and yet it's one coherent whole. No other book like it in the world. I believe that's why there is more textual evidence for this ancient book than there is any other ancient text. And I want to get into details about that, but the manuscript evidence that what we have is accurate and historical and close to the time of Jesus is incredible. Investigate it. Join us for Alpha in January. You'll find out more. I believe that is why the call of the kingdom of God is a call that rises above all other worldviews. Whatever movement, ideology, philosophy that you've heard out there in this world, there is nothing like the call of the kingdom of God. It transforms our lives, and it's a call for us as followers of Jesus Christ to be engaged in transforming this world. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the testimony that you've given us through the person of Jesus Christ, the historical figure of Jesus Christ. Lord, we have treasure buried in our attic. We've got dusty Bibles and dusty confessions and beliefs about who Jesus Christ is that we need to take out and dust off and recover the value, not only for us, but for the world. I pray that we would be people who do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing of His glory, and I hope you experience the mysterious touch of the Spirit as you sing.
When peace like a river
Thanks so much for being with us today. A couple of things I want you to be aware of. Our preschool has started. I believe it's our fourth year of preschool. We're expanding, so we're doing a lot of work around church to expand the area so we can add more students to our preschool. Will you be in prayer about that? And just if you can support that ministry in any way and support the ministry of Sunlight Church, you'll find the donate button on our website and in our weekly update. You can give through PayPal, you can send checks. It's so vital that we be supportive of the ministry during this time. Also, we distribute food every Thursday afternoon. If you know people in this community that are in need, send them our way Thursday afternoon from 4 to 6, an important way that we connect. We're also opening up the doors for students, school-age students in our county, Palm Beach County here in South Florida. Students aren't yet able to be physically present in school. So until then, we know that parents have the challenge of providing a safe, supervised place for their children. Some of them have to work and have other responsibilities. So we're going to provide 4 hours every weekday morning, and we need volunteers to be a part of that. We're going to screen them. We're going to make sure we follow safety protocols to make sure they stay safe. But that's an opportunity. We're going to provide some rooms here at the church that we can provide a safe place for school-age kids. So if you can be a part of that and help us out. Thanks so much for being a part of Sunlight Church in whatever way you're involved. Receive God's blessing as you go today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and give you his peace and his presence through his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.